Hey everybody out there, this is Dave with the Bass Channel, and today we are checking out my steampunk custom bass. If you are one of the billions and billions of people that have existed on this planet between 2019 and now being December 2021, then you might be familiar with a little thing called the coronavirus or COVID-19 pandemic. And what seems to have happened, especially in 2020, is that everybody got themselves a hobby or a project or a whole new form of passion that took up their time for the year, thinking that at least, you know, it would be done by the end of the year, and then it wasn't. And I'm no different. I did not pick up, baking bread or brewing my own beer or needlepoint or whatever like that. But what I did was I decided to build a bass.
Good morning from the lounge. It's a little early, so my hair is still totally screwed and I'm working on some coffee, but as you can see by the box and packing materials behind me, I got my body and neck for my bass project. So let's have a look.
All right, over on the workbench, here we have the body and the neck. As mentioned, that just came from Reverb. According to the Reverb seller, these came from the Zola Guitars shop. Bill Zola apparently looks like an unfinished project. As you can see, it's got the Ernie Ball silhouette, Music Man silhouette, Van Halen body shape to it with a P route for the pickup. Looks like it's got kind of a Music Man style 3+1 headstock. And it's basically just unfinished. The final shaping, you can see it's a little rough here across the top edge of the headstock. The truss rod cutout isn't completely done. Truss rod's in there though, I checked. The fret markers on the 12th fret are a little bit off kilter, but not a huge deal to me. The top is carved just shallowly across, so that's kind of nice. I'm actually going to add a belly cut to it. I started kind of sketching that on there already on the workbench. I'm going to see how that shapes out. The whole thing should be a really nice lightweight. It's a short scale 30-inch bass, and all the parts, the body and the neck, and then I threw some hardware on top of it on the scale, is, you know, under 5.5 pounds so far, and that's without electronics or of course the big, like the neck bolts or what have you. So I'm hoping for a nice lightweight short scale bass, and yeah, that's gonna be pretty cool when it's done, I think. The body was just slab. It was not contoured in any way. And the neck, of course, was just a cast-off neck. So this body and this neck from Zola Guitars became my platform. And I got it home, or I got it in the mail from Reverb. And it was a couple $100, not too bad. And so then I set out to make a plan, and I actually recreated the body shape in Fusion 360, did a 3D model of it, and then I started experimenting with kind of what some of the pieces would look like. I have always super dug steampunk stuff, right? So the cool wood and you know, gears and brass and rust, and you know, the idea of technology having evolved along the mechanical steam engine type route instead of the electronic silicon chip microprocessor kind of route has always been kind of cool to me. I don't subscribe to the often maligned steampunk practice of just stick some gears on it and it's steampunk automatically. I like it when all of the pieces at least either serve an aesthetic function in a nice way, or serve a function, or at least could be construed to do so, even if they don't really. And I had a couple of pieces of hardware that I wanted to use, like this cool steam power kind of faceplate and valve knob that I wanted to use. And I'm like, you know what? Let's fucking do it. I got started by literally carving the body myself. And you know, we'll cut to some video clips of that kind of thing.
So one thing I don't know if I mentioned when I was setting up this base project is I don't have a whole bunch of woodworking tools. I'm just using the most super basic stuff.
I used a keyhole saw to parallel cut a bunch of relief cuts along some pencil line to meet up with some pencil lines that I had drawn for the contour. And then I literally chipped out all of that wood with a bench knife and then sanded it to oblivion, filed it and sanded it, and eventually finished it with a Dremel.
Oh yeah, look at how smooth that came out. I think it's pretty good for some cheap hand tools and a little bit of time.
Not only that, but made a couple mistakes along the way.
I can't get my wood glue open.
All right, so I'm just gonna use a pair of flush cutters. The ones I use for my 3D prints should be sharp enough and flush enough at cutting. Aha! Good of you to come back to us. All right. And now you can see a mostly perfectly plugged hole. When it was time, though, to make it an actual functional instrument, I could, you know, get the body to kind of where I wanted it. But I knew that it would need a little bit more professional help. So I called up my friend, Kevin Brubaker.
If you can't tell, I'm up at Brubaker Guitars in Baltimore. We're going to, me and Kevin are going to work on this bass a little bit.
I had met Kevin Brubaker of Brubaker Guitars in Baltimore, Maryland, because of his repair work. I had never owned a Brubaker instrument, but I had a bass a couple of years back that needed some help. And I was referred to Kevin for his repair work and refinish work, actually. And we kind of formed a friendship, and we did some stuff for one another. I've done a little bit of kind of helping him do some design work. I've done some 3D printing prototypes for him, things like that. As a thank you, he has helped me on this space project. And really, it was awesome. When I got the body and neck to him and said, hey, can we just, you know, put these together, you know, set it up, throw a finish on it, throw some electronics in it, what have you. He said, sure. And then he picked up the neck. He took one look at the neck and he said, oh, this entire fretboard needs to be redone.
Oh no, Kevin took the neck.
We had to reshape the entire fretboard, replaned it. We would pull the frets out, replaned it. So they showed me how to cut my own fret wire, and I cut the tang for the fret wire. And between me and Kevin and Mark Snyder, another guy at Brubaker, we managed to fix up the fretboard entirely and refret the neck. And all that was amazing. And also this wonderful walnut finish over this quilt is also thanks to the guys at Brubaker. I had them do matching headstock. And of course the body. I left the stripe open, the blonde stripe open on the arm bevel, but I don't think I like it now that the brass is on there. So I'm probably going to darken that up a little bit. Once we got it finished and we got electronics in it, I asked if they could do me a custom circuit. The pickup is an EMG geezer, just regular P pickup, passive P pickup. But the tone knob has been replaced with a three-way switch up in the Les Paul poker chip position that goes completely wide open in the middle with no resistors, capacitors, anything in the circuit, just wired straight to the jack. Then if you flip it up, it has a couple of resistors in series to cut off some of the treble. So it's just kind of a subtle treble roll off in case I'm running through a rig or a pedal or something that's too bright. And then flip it down this way for completely tone at zero, that all bass, all the time, thick, woofy, thumpy tone. And you might notice that it's also got a Ray Ross saddleless bridge on it. This was kind of a new option coming into the Brubaker shop at the time. Basically, we were talking about what kind of bridge do you want, and he suggested the Ray Ross might be a cool, interesting new thing. Plus, it's brass. Plus, it's got kind of that industrial kind of gearing wheel kind of look that would go with the bass in general. And I said, yeah, let's try it. And you saw our video on the Ray Ross Saddleless Bridge. If you didn't, check it out over here. And I really liked the way it turned out, especially because I had planned on putting flat wounds on this. It's got Diodario chrome flat wounds on the bass. And I think the balance between the tone circuit and the bridge and the strings, it's pretty lively, even if it does sound kind of like a mid-forward P in a lot of settings.
As you can see here on the body, we've got the Ray Ross bridge installed now. We've got, I just put my steam power volume plate on there with a couple of temporary screws. Obviously we're going to have to drill for the volume knob, and the volume knob I'm going to use, or try to use, hoping it fits on the pots, is again this brass valve here. I think that'll look pretty cool. Up at the headstock, you can see we've got your 3+1 sort of Ernie Ball style tuner action arrangement going on there. I did actually, I've got a toothpick here because I'm about to fill a little hole, because originally we went with, I really need a neck rest, a real neck rest for my bench, because I don't have one at all now. So originally we had the hole here because the tuner was actually parallel to the other tuners, but from the front it just didn't look right. So I went ahead and dug a new hole in there and moved it over and spun it around. So I'm going to take a toothpick and some wood glue and I'm going to fill this little hole, and then the tuner situation should be pretty much set anyway. On the back you can see how nicely the belly carve has come out. And I noticed on some other guitars and basses that their belly cuts just go straight to the edge and straight to the edge. And I thought, I didn't even think to do that. Like, I thought it should be kind of rounded off and rounded off. You know, obviously this isn't finished sanded yet, but we got a nice plain neck plate on there for now. I'm kind of sketching out how I want to sculpt this little heel bit a little bit. And I'm probably going to put, you know, kind of a more fancy kind of neck plate on this guy. But the neck pocket now fits nice and smooth and tight. And it's very cool. And super, super good work by my friends Mark and Kevin, of course, Kevin Brubaker of Brubaker Guitars.
The brass work on here, there's a couple of different pieces. This thing that says steam power on it and the knob, those came from Vintage Wire and Supply. And Vintage Wire and Supply have a lot of stuff for people who like steampunk stuff. It's basically just retro, electrical, plumbing, you know, all that kind of stuff. We can cut that if you want, but leave it in there, whatever. Same with the switch ring. The switch itself is a Gretsch tone switch with a gold Gretsch top on it. And the brass pieces are from a company called Send Cut Send. Basically, I sent them the CAD drawings of these pieces that I had made in my 3D model, and they cut them out of brass and sent them back to me. It's raw brass, so it's kind of tarnishing here. And the piece that is behind the volume wheel and under the bridge has a whole bunch of detail in it that they were able to cut out because they just laser cut the metal and send it on out. Well, that was exactly to my CAD drawings, and to this day, it's still blank in there. And that is because I had a plan for putting something in there, and then I just haven't been able to find the right pieces yet. That is where you're going to see kind of some gears, maybe a tube or two, and maybe like an LED light or something. But I haven't quite found the parts that just, yes, that would look perfect in there. So it's kind of a work in development. It's got the jack on the outside here. So the rear covers for the tone switch and for the control knob area, I 3D printed myself just because it was faster and easier than, you know, having more, yet more brass pieces cut, and you know, they weigh a little less.
This rosewood is kind of chocolatey smelling.
So it's a 30-inch scale, short scale base, and it weighs around about 7.5 pounds. So another thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to get a couple of more metal pieces cut that have a little bit more intricate detail to them now that I kind of know where visually I'm going with this. I'm going to have, you know, some things maybe with some etchings in them, you know, like some... like some, you know, create sonic explosions from your very hands. You know, kind of thing. Give it a little bit of that early 1900s feel. I have called it, I have decided to call this base, because of the shape and because of the steampunk theme, I'm calling it the Electric Teapot. So yeah, so that is this funky, weird steampunk bass that you may have seen on my Instagram or on a couple of earlier videos here on the channel. And if you'd been wondering about it, then, well, now you know. And if you haven't been wondering about it, then, well, I told you about it anyway. So nanny nanny boo boo. And as always, this is Dave with the Bass Channel, and I'll see you next time.